bend the track, cover it up, we'll live without. Baby, my love is only doubling up. Yes, I'll be faithful, yes, I'll be real. Yes, and with that, you'll always know the deal.
How are you? Good evening. Welcome to Relationship Matters. And tonight, I know for certain it's going to be interesting, to say the least. Thank you for joining us so much. My name is Stephen Aite, and this is my lovely bride. 20 years ago, I came across this lovely damsel in the Ghana School of Law, and I was smitten just watching her. And here we are. So, tonight we get to come into your homes, get to come to you wherever you are, and to just enjoy fellowship with you. So I'm trusting God, and I'm believing that together we'll have an amazing, amazing time. So just feel free, take a seat, you know, relax, and let's get into this together. All right? Awesome. So tonight we are going to talk about, you have something you want to say more? Before I proceed, no?
We haven't prayed.
So, yeah. Lady Monica will do the honors. She's my bishop, she's my pastor.
Wow.
She'll do the honors.
See how it works in this house. It just got thrown back to me. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this opportunity. We thank you for the medium that we can gather on tonight to hear about one of the most important things you created in the beginning. This evening, we pray for wisdom, we pray for knowledge, we pray for understanding. We pray that you will release our tongues to speak that which pleases you and that which will help your people. I commit everybody on the line into your hands. I pray that they will learn something here tonight to enrich their lives, enrich their marriages, and above all, to improve their relationship with you. We thank you, Holy Spirit. We know that you're here with us. Take control and take us through this. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Oh, well, well, well. So welcome to Demystifying Sex. I must tell you that I was petrified of the topic chosen by, and it was chosen by the ladies. So don't look at me with those Worcester judgmental eyes. Look at these ladies who chose the topic. I'm all innocent here. But in all seriousness, I must say that we know that the current reality of our times is not lost on you, neither is it lost on us. I am well aware that we are in a COVID-19 pandemic season. About 110,000 people almost have died. Last week, the killing of George Floyd, that video that went viral, erupted, protests everywhere, and actually I think that the whole thing with George Floyd has gone as viral as the COVID-19 pandemic has gone. And so we are aware that many of you are feeling a certain sense of stress. Many of you are feeling worried. You are disturbed in your homes. There are things that are on your minds. But I think that a discussion like this also at this time allows you to sort of like lessen the weight of the somberness of the mood where those events are concerned, where everything is about death and killings and everything else, and to discuss something that I know most people find interesting. So I hope that you will understand the spirit with which we do this tonight, and that you will set your heart and your mind at ease, and you know, come along with us for this ride. All right? Okay. So why is this topic important now? Now, in my opinion, COVID-19 is scary. No two ways about it. But COVID-19 has left us with a lot of time on our hands. And for those of you who are single and not married, and even those who are married, I've got about three reports of people who have COVID-19 seats have been taking. So COVID-19 has had a lot of time on our hands. And the passion and the anger with the whole George Floyd death situation and Black Lives Matter and the protests and everything, we don't want you also ending up tumbling into sheets to release your pent-up anger. And so this might be a good time, we think, to just have a discussion with you, come into your home and share some ideas and some thoughts with you, and then together build up healthy and good relationships and marriages therefrom. So let me say that tonight's topic is demystifying sex. And the word demystifying basically just speaks about making something that is complex or esoteric and taking it and making it clearer, making it more understandable, breaking it down to bite-sized pieces, if you like, so we can all understand it. And when we say sex, what do we even mean?
Sexual intercourse, yeah,
basically,
right.
Now sexual intercourse, as the Bible defines it, as between a man and a woman, a husband and a wife, you know. So if you don't fit into the parameters of husband and wife or man and woman tonight, don't feel like we are looking down on anybody or anything, but we want to set the tone for to keep the discussion within a certain limit, otherwise we'll be all about the place with it. All right, so let's look at sex. Let's talk about sex, baby. Let's talk about you and me. Oh, for tonight. Save that for tonight. Anyway, so are there any good reasons at all to have sex? And I think that, you know, from where I said, or where we said as pastors and as counselors, sex has certain importance within the context of a marriage. You know, number one, sex is for procreation, for creating new babies. In other words, sex gives you the ability to fulfill the mandate that God gave to man, to create new life. In other words, when you have sex with an intention of bringing forth children, you are literally acting like God. Sex helps you fulfill a God-like function, helps you do what God wants you to do. The second thing to perhaps think about is that sex is for recreation and pleasure.
Yeah.
Now, that's where we are, that's what we like, that's what we got to do, recreation and pleasure. No planning for kids, nothing, just have a go at it, have fun. Now, we qualify to enjoy that because we've had our kids already. Number one, we've been married for 16 years, 15 going on to 16 years. We've had our kids already, so we can decide to just, you know, do this for, you know, the heck of it. So it's for recreation or pleasure. The third thing is that sex is for communication, helps communication in marriages. Many times where people come to you with a marital situation or a marital problem, and you're counseling them and you find that things are not going well. If you start asking questions about or probing further, you find that the problem starts in the bedroom. So sex enables a couple to be better at communication, you know, when you you know, mutually enjoy each other. And lastly, it's for release, your pent-up emotions, your feelings, your tensions, the difficulties you are facing, all of these come out. Now, the Bible says in Proverbs 5, verse 22, that the cords of sin will hold fast. That is, sin will have lasting implications for a person if they engage in sexual immorality, or they engage in a wrongful sexual act. And we will cover what those should be also in a few. So today, basically, we are going to narrow down on three major things. Number one, sexual soul ties. Number two, sexual do's and don'ts of dating. And number three, healthy sexual habits in a marriage. How do you
covering everything?
How do you keep your habits healthy and keep you going and keep your sexiness up? All right, so let's start with the first part of it, sexual soul ties. And to be able to understand what sexual soul ties are, perhaps we need to take a broader view of everything and to comprehend it. Now, soul ties is a broader topic than sexual soul ties. So we will absolutely segue into sexual soul ties. But to understand what sexual soul ties are, perhaps we need to start from understanding what soul ties are. Okay, a soul tie is a connection that two people make at a certain level, and the subject is more complicated than that because it's not just a connection, it forms a certain bond, a certain union, if you like, whether you are aware or you wanted to form a union or not. Yeah. It creates a union and a bond that goes beyond the physical. Now, in Genesis chapter 1, verse 25, at the tail end of verse 25, the Bible said that after God had made all things, God saw that it was good. So everything God saw, then he thought it was good. Then in verse 26, we are told that God looked again and God says, maybe it's not so good. We need something beyond what we see or we've made. So God, which is God in totality, Father, Word, and Spirit, have a meeting. And they say, let us make man in our image. Okay, according to our likeness. That likeness, that image there refers to not a physical but a spiritual personality and a moral likeness. So God created man in his own image, and again he repeats, in the image of God created he him, male and female he made them. So tonight, whatever we say covers both husband and wife, both fiancé and courting mate or boy, girl, whatever. Now, it's important to know that the Bible says that God made man in his image, so that the spiritual nature of man, what makes man a spirit, is captured at once in the image of God. That is captured, that is perfected. But then the Bible says that he made him according to his likeness, or other scripture says he made him after his likeness. So he patterned man after his likeness, not in his likeness, but after his likeness. So the image of God, that which pertains to a spirit of a man, is formed already. But when it comes to the moral likeness, there is some work to be done to make us become like God. And that is where our choices rest. Okay, so man is made, and man is a tripartite, like body, soul, and spirit. Now the spirit, which reflects God or looks like God or is fully God, it belongs to God already. The Bible says the spirit of man is a candle of the Lord. Proverbs 20:27. The Bible says that Job 28. The Bible says that the spirit of a man receives understanding from the Lord. So it is the Lord that allows a man to sort of like communicate to him by spirit. So it is a spirit to spirit thing. So the spirit of a man is already established in God.
Yeah.
Now the problem is that man is a soul and a spirit, too. Unseen elements housed in a visible element called a body. Now, man is trying to save this body to which your spirit and your soul have been assigned and make it ready to and fit it for heaven, if you like. And the Bible is saying that yes, what God has done, the spirit already connects to God and the soul can be intertwined with the spirit, but the soul's ability to connect with the spirit to bring the flesh where God wants it to be depends on man's obedience to the word of God. So Hebrews 4 verse 12, the Bible says the word of God is able to separate and divide into two, you know, spirit and soul. In other words, the two are not the same and there's a distinction. Now many times we call the soul of a man his heart, but it's not a ball of muscle in your chest cavity. It refers to that which goes beyond. It is the seat of your emotions and feelings, the generator of your thoughts. It is the controller of your moods. And your soul is actually where your will and your moral likeness is fully formed and shaped. And you must make decisions that make your will and your personality begin to conform to what God wants you to conform to. So you are made after a certain moral likeness, and you must pursue that moral likeness. So in order for God to get man to become more like him, God allows the soul of a man to have an experience, if you like, and that experience attaches itself to a situation or a thing,
mm-hmm.
and then allows man to build up from there. So I am going to say to you that in spite of everything you might have heard, man will be on all fours, but you know, there's a gentleman called Moses who is taking care of sheep, and the Bible says that there is a bush that seems to be burning, but it's not burning. And so Moses, number one, gets a sense of attraction to something, and now when he gets near to it, the thing, when he gets there, there's a conversation that ensues between Moses and God. He finds out to talk to God and get to know God. God gains his attention, and out of that, God now has his affection. Now, I use the word affection because if he buys into the soul of Moses, that to a degree where Moses' heart, Moses' mind, and Moses' person, he yearns for more of God. Like David said, as the deer panteth for water, so does my soul long after you. And so God uses that desire, that yearning, that passion within a man to long for him, to create that connection that allows a man to grow in him. So a husband and a wife come together. There is a soul connection that allows us to grow and to form one image and to grow into that image. It is something biblical. It is found between a mentor and a mentee. You will find that Christ Jesus would literally bring the men around him, Peter and Co. pardon me, to a point where they literally would be yearning or desiring to go, you know, with him and after him. So there are many kinds of soul ties, and God uses this to build your passion and to help you strive for excellence in everything you do. Now, this is a system that God has set up, and even prayer, we are told that fortunately, unfortunately, your body works like a system, and the enemy has figured out that, okay, if God uses this thing to be able to get man to conform to his image, then I can also infiltrate it, create a wrongful relationship, build up that yearning, that feeling, that desire, and then lead man out of the plan of God.
Right.
So the devil introduces you to all sort of wrongful relationships, going the wrong way. There are quite a few examples of soul ties in the Bible. Jonathan and
David
had a very strong soul tie, beautiful friendship. Ruth and Naomi
mm-hmm.
had a beautiful friendship that was a soul tie. Elijah, Elisha, that kind of commitment to wanting to be there, it also creates a soul tie. So soul ties could be in a family by biological means, it could be socially as between friends, it could be emotional, it could be spiritual, or it could be physical. But tonight we would like to narrow down to spiritual soul ties, and especially of the sexual variety and what it causes. And I would ask Lady Monica to just chime in and begin to run with me here.
Okay. So yes, Pastor just gave us an overview, right, on soul ties. Because normally when we hear the term soul ties, automatically our minds go to something negative. So there was a need to break it all down to let you know that it's not always bad, but we are segueing into sexual soul ties. So, you know, sometimes people make comments like, oh, the church just talks too much about sex. They make it seem as if, you know, sex is the worst sin ever, and we talk too much about sex. Sometimes sex is just sex and it's nothing else. But really, if you look at the definition, if you look at the way God created sex, or what God defined it to be, sex is not just sex, right? There is more to it than that. Beyond that physical joining of bodies, there's an emotional joining, a spiritual joining, I don't want to say soulful, but you know, a soulish
mm-hmm.
joining, but something that goes just beyond that physical connection. And sex is so important that even when you get married to a person and you don't consummate the marriage, or you don't seal it with sex, it is not a proper marriage, and it can easily be annulled. That is how important sex is. And God, right from the beginning in Genesis, I believe chapter 2 verse 24, he did say that so a man will leave his mother and father, cleave to his wife, and the two shall become one. That oneness, that unity that comes into existence through sex is something that Paul calls a mystery in Ephesians chapter 5. It's something that we cannot really explain. So if you ask me how 1 + 1 becomes 2 in marriage, I cannot tell you. God says that is what it is. And if you've ever had any sexual relations with anybody, you know that something more happened than just that physical release. Now, Jesus also comes to repeat the same thing in Matthew chapter 19. Again, anything that is repeated is for emphasis, and it tells you how important it is. So man leaving his father, coming together to be united with his wife, and then the two become one flesh, all right? So again, emphasizing that joining that happens that none of us can understand is deeper. Then in Ephesians chapter 5, which I mentioned earlier on, Paul also repeats the same scripture again, talking about the union between a man and a woman, and that union bringing them into that oneness or that unity that we cannot explain. And he said, what, it's a profound mystery. That was Ephesians chapter 5, verse 32, a profound mystery. Now, the Bible does not say anything about soul ties. If you can't find the term soul tie, but it's a term that has, you know, been used to refer to, again, that bond that comes into existence, that invisible bond that comes into existence when two people join together in a sexual activity. But then we can say that maybe the go-to scripture for sexual soul ties would be 1 Corinthians chapter 6. So let's just skip. If you have a Bible, don't worry, we're not doing a sermon here, but it's important to, you know, make sure that we are catching, catching your attention and making sure that we are taking you into the Bible, because that's what this is all about. So 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 15, it says, "Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? And shall I then take the members of Christ and make them members of a harlot, a prostitute? Certainly not. Or do you not know," this is what Paul says, "that he who is joined to a harlot is one body with the harlot, a prostitute. For the two," he says, "he being God, shall become one flesh. But he who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him." So that tells you right there that is serious stuff, right? So then there's nothing like casual sex, because that sexual encounter with a prostitute was really what the world calls casual. Nobody goes to a prostitute to go and get anything of any of the stuff we talked about, the appropriation, the communication. You just want to release. You just want to get something quick and casual and go away. But then Paul is telling us that when you do that, something comes into existence. Mm-hmm. You're joined. And when your physical body is separate, that joint still remains. And it leads to lasting consequences, right? This is what one preacher said. He said that sex is like a fire. And just as fire needs boundaries, sex also needs boundaries. And the boundaries for sex is marriage. Mm-hmm. God himself created that and gave it a boundary. All right. So every time there's a sexual intercourse, you become what with the person you unite with. Every time there's sexual intercourse, you become. So that should tell you from now on that you need to change your perspective on sex. If you think that it is nothing short of, "Oh, I'm bored, I'm just going to look for some booty to tap." Listen, you're not just tapping booty, you're tapping all manner of things. And we'll go into that. "Oh, I'm kind of thirsty, you know, who's available?" You're not just satisfying some physical desire. You think you were, but beyond that, you're taking on all manner of things that you're not even aware of, okay? So then as I was thinking this through, what happens to, you know, unconsenting sex, right? Or, you know, sexual molestation, rape, things that happen without your consent. Because if you look at 1 Corinthians chapter 6, what I quoted, he said, "If you join yourself to a harlot," which means you took yourself to go and do the joining, right? And then the harlot also consented. So there's some amount of consent in there. But what if you raped? What if it was not with your consent? There's a tie still coming to existence. So of course I combed through the Bible to find something, because I want everything to sound authentic. And the closest thing I found was in Genesis chapter 34 from 1-3, where Dinah, Jacob's only daughter, was raped by Shechem. Right. I mean, Shechem, the prince of Shechem, okay? And then the Bible says in verse 3, which I quoted here, it said, "And his soul," I'm doing KJV because I love the word, "and his soul clave," right? Mm-hmm. The same word, cleave, you know? "His soul clave unto Dinah, the daughter of Jacob." And that happened after the rape. After that heinous act, his soul clave. Dinah liked it or no, she didn't like it. I mean, it was a rape. But something still came into existence, which to me just says that whenever you have sex, whether it's consenting or non-consenting, some bond comes into play, some tie is established, something happens in the invisible realm. And if you go to the same 34 verse 8, it says, "But Hamor, the father of Shechem, spoke with them," with the sons of Jacob, "The soul of my son Shechem longs for your daughter. please give her to him as a wife. And all that happened after the rape. After the rape. So whatever kind of sexual intercourse that happens, some soul tie is established. Yeah. So coming over to you. What are the signs of a soul tie?
Well, before we even get there, I'd like to say that, you know, you have to understand that the soul is designed to be able to have an experience that it holds on to. And so it could be passionate or it could be something that is negative, but the soul holds on to it. And the instincts of feelings that develop can either starve faith and feed fear, or maybe increase faith and then also starve fear, negative or positive. Now, if you understand also that your soul is a bridge between your flesh and the spirit, then it is the goal of God's system is always harmony. Everything must work at the same, at a setting optimum.
Mm-hmm.
So when systems work in harmony, everything is right with you, and then your soul brings your flesh over towards your spirit, and then understanding process and everything goes right. Now, because your body is a system, when your soul cannot appreciate the experience, or your soul is not quite, you have a certain age where your brain is not fully developed, or your Christian maturity is not full, and so your soul cannot grasp the pleasurable part of an exercise, or your soul cannot understand exactly what is happening. What then happens is that you Satan feeds in deception, and your raging hormones or still developing intellect or your immaturity or whatever can lead you to a place where, based on a wrong relationship, you form a soul tie without realizing what has happened to you. So you become hooked on, or you become stuck on somebody, you know, you become so literally you find it impossible to break away from a thing. But many times it happens because a level of maturity or appreciation of the preceding events have not been reached. Let's say a kid reaches a certain age where hormones are raging, but mentally and emotionally you are not advanced enough and to understand what you're about to do, or your body is developed, like you are 18 or 17 years old, you have a banging body, you know, every man is looking at you and whistling, you know, everywhere, cat calls everywhere. The flesh has preceded the development of your soul.
Mm.
And so I seem to, you know, go crazy, you know, because something is wrong. There's no harmony in the way the system that God designed it's working. So the first thing to be aware of before any wrongful soul ties is watch what relationships you have. Please, soul ties are always formed through relationships that you create. So please watch the relationships that you have. So let's talk about sexual soul ties. What are some of the signs that you are in a sexual soul tie? Are in a sexual soul tie typically, and I think I have to sit up to talk about this. The power that you wield as a human being, the sovereignty, the capacity, the capabilities that God has given to you is literally taking out of your hands. And so you are not able to function to the fullness of the capacity of what you carry. So for instance, you become fixated on the person for no reason. They are always on your mind. You are always checking out the, you know, and listen, anybody can have a crush. Anybody can go through an emotional period of ooh and ah over somebody else. But when it gets so bad that you are checking out the person page 16 times in maybe 3 minutes, you know, you are composing text to send, the next minute you are doing this, you are doing that, it goes a little beyond. Now, I'm not talking about being in high school and spotting a boy across the room and daydreaming for 5 minutes and writing him a love note, or the day before your paper writing a letter and suddenly realizing, oops, I got to study, and then getting back to your books. I'm talking about if you know you have 2 hours to the exam, using 1.5 hours daydreaming about this dude, then you are fixated on that person and something is seriously wrong. The second thing that becomes a sign many times is a surrender of your will to another. It's like you no longer have a will of your own. Everything is about what this person wants. What does this person want? You eat what they want to eat. You sleep when they want to sleep. You run when they want you to run. You jump when they want you to jump. Something is definitely wrong. you know, and it's something to be aware of. You no longer are able to exercise your own will. When you ask the question, you've got to go look at him and say, listen, what should I do? Or look at her and say, how should I, you know, answer this or do that? The third thing I've mentioned is a loss of identity. When you are married, you bring your own identity to the union, and the two become one and forge a new identity. So the two build up an identity out of two unique identities. But in a soul tie, your identity is completely swallowed up in another person's identity. It's like the person tells you, I don't like long hair, you got to shave off all your hair. They tell you, I don't like you dark, you got to start bleaching. Then you begin to lose your identity, you lose your focus. The fourth thing you might notice is somebody who has undue influence over you. They can get you to do things that you didn't want to do, not in a positive way, but in a negative way. That is a sure sign that there is a soul tie somewhere there. It could end up in manipulation. Number five, manipulation. You could be manipulated in many ways. You could be led to say things or do things you don't want to do, you don't want to say, and now you are being manipulated. Sometimes it's making you not talk to people around you. Don't talk to these people. Don't talk to your family. Move away from your family. Move your lip. That's manipulation. That is wrong. And of course, manipulation comes with control. Now you lie to the person. If they say they don't like what you're wearing, you can't wear it. They must literally choose your clothes for you. I mean, listen, if you're a guy and you're taking some girl through this thing, stop it. It's so tedious how women choose their dresses. You want to choose a lady's dress? Something's wrong with you, dude.
Yeah, that's soul tie working, so you know.
All right, soul tie. So the seventh point that I'll make there is abuse. Where you find abuse, and people are living with the abuse, then there is a soul tie. Sometimes it's physical abuse, sometimes it's mental abuse, sometimes it's just emotional abuse. Where you are constantly going under abuse, but you are making excuses for the person. Oh, he's going to change next week. He's going to change in 2 weeks' time. Oh, and well, you know, one of those most dramatic ones when people come for counseling and somebody brings a guy to you as a pastor or as a counselor, and you can spot from a mile off that this person is wrong for this person and this is not going to work. And they're like, oh, you know, the Lord has told me that he's the one and I'm praying to change him. And I'm like, sister, God has never given anybody a ministry to change anybody for marriage. You are playing with fire. So you find that kind of behavior, which feeds into number eight, irrational behavior. Completely irrational behavior. They get you to empty your bank account, take a loan on their behalf. You know, you co-sign a loan that, you know, you give your car out. All sort of weird things that you're doing. You've maxed out your credit card. You know, everything is not going well because somebody's you. It's all about Ricky. Without Ricky, you can't breathe. Irrational behavior. Honey, we have a problem. Oh, Houston, we are in trouble. The ninth thing I've mentioned there is when you start misplacing your priorities or poor decision making. For instance, you could have a child of your own and then you meet somebody else, and then a soul tie is formed because of sexual soul tie, because of you had a sexual encounter, and then suddenly you are not even remembering where your children are or your child is, but you're focusing on, you know, taking care of somebody's children. I was listening to a story where a man of God was talking about a gentleman who had left his marital home with five kids, moved with another woman who had children by four different men,
right,
and was taking care of them.
That's right.
And so she came to see this pastor. I think it was Pastor Deboye who was talking about this.
Right.
And they had prayed in a meeting, and he said he will come home. Yeah. And so about 3 days later, there's an argument that is going on. And thank God for the divine intervention of prayer. We'll come to what breaks the soul tie. But when Pastor Deboye says, when they are having an argument where this man is, the woman says, if you are not crazy, will you leave your five children and your wife and come and take care of mine for 3 years? And the man is like, yeah, something is wrong here. Something is wrong. So luckily for him, that's how his soul tie got broken.
Right.
He grabbed his bags. And just like the man of God had said, on the third day, he was knocking his wife's door begging, please give me a place to sleep.
Right.
Said, please, yeah. Come here, this is your home.
No, it's, I had another story by another preacher, again, that this, he was talking about a woman who was actually a pastor's kid, and she had been with a man for 11 years. They were basically just living together. The man wasn't willing to commit. He would go, he would come. This woman has had kids with the guy, but he would just go, come whenever he wants, you know, come and get some, go away for a few days, come back.
Get some what?
Bouteille. Go away, you know, come back.
That's
and,
a thing of saying,
and the woman, the man wasn't committing, the woman couldn't move. Clearly something was wrong, you know, then that is how soul ties get formed. Mm-hmm. Something had been formed that nobody understood. Everybody would tell her he's not going to commit, and she knows it too, but for some reason she just can't tear herself away. Some said, oh, maybe it's the children, but no, it is beyond that.
11 years. She's a double PhD program.
11 years. Yeah.
Well, the 10th sign for me would be stagnation. You've come to stagnation in your life. You can't move on with somebody else. Other people are knocking at your door. People are crying for your attention, but nothing moves you. You are stuck. You are not able to move, and you've been this way for 11 years because of one person. The 11th thing is bondage, where it's a completely negative impact on your life, and you feel like spiritually something is wrong. You've been shackled, and many times there's a sense of heaviness, or there is something I'm missing in your spirit. There's unhappiness. There is no joy. There's misery in your spirit, and it's a spiritual bondage, but you really don't know how to come out of it. And the last thing I've mentioned is an interesting one. I call it presence in absence. So that when somebody has a sexual soul tie and they have that much influence over you, even when they are not around, they dominate your thinking in your mind. It's a mental dominion. You are always imagining them being with you. You are imagining them being with you. The second point is an emotional dominion. You are obsessed by them. So you go and buy the food they used to eat. You buy the clothes, the colors they like to wear. You buy the perfume he used to wear or she used to wear. You're spraying your room with the perfume. You're obsessing. And the third thing is a spiritual dominion, where now you are carrying it to your dreams, and it's turning out to be sexual dreams. And a demon is also now using that thing, using that image to come in and to create, you know, an incubus or a succubus covenant with you. Look, soul ties can be pretty messy and pretty damning. You want to do whatever you can to avoid it. The number one panacea, avoid the sexual connection.
True. Again, because without that, then all these things will not happen. So looking at all that we have said, pretty serious stuff, right? Some deep stuff. So you do want to break these. You don't want this as part of your life for the rest of your life. So whenever there's a soul tie, whenever you realize that there's a soul tie, or even if as we are talking, you're becoming a nation, like, oh snap, this is me. Oh, number four was me. Number five, that's my sister. Oh my gosh, that's my cousin. Oh, this is me again. Listen, you need to break it. So what do you do, or how do you break soul ties? Everything we have said shows that it is something that is beyond the physical. So first of all, we have to go to God and ask him in prayer to show you, do I have any soul ties that need to be broken? If the Lord begins to bring people to your mind, or you think that of anybody with whom there's a possibility of a soul tie, you proceed to pray and to cut, you know, that tie. Also be willing to acknowledge and confess as sin any sexual immorality leading to that soul tie. Again, any sexual activity you've had outside of marriage is wrong. And listen, we're not here to condemn anybody. We're actually here to offer you solutions if you have found yourself in this situation. So yes, even though all that we have said, some of it is scary, we're also here to offer solutions. We're not saying that you have this tie and that's it. You're gone, you're stuck, you're done. No, we're saying go to God and then be willing to acknowledge it, right? And renounce any soul ties that you may have based on all that we have said. Renounce these sexual soul ties that you may have. And make sure also to forgive yourself. Make sure to forgive yourself, because the moment you confess, the moment you acknowledge, confess, God forgives you. Make sure that you forgive yourself, because the thing with that forgiveness is that it could still tie you unknowingly to the act or to the person. And unforgiveness again becomes a blockade to you enjoying your freedom. Even though you have been freed of it, you can't really enjoy it because unforgiveness becomes a blockade. And then forgive the other person, especially if it was a non-consensual sexual act that brought all this into being. Forgive the other person, and also be willing to submit yourself to God's guidance, to the Holy Spirit, for him to take you through, or to take you, you know, from here on, so that you can live that fulfilling life that God intended for you to have. God demands to have first place in our hearts, and when these soul ties come into place, they sort of unseat God from that first place and put somebody else there. And then, you know, all the demonic things that follow that person, or the demonic things that follow the creation of that soul tie, also become a limitation in your life. and they stop you from moving forward to get to where God wants you to go to. So remember all that I'm saying. Go to God, ask Him, hey, have any soul ties? Or just think through what we have said, and if you discover that there's any, begin to pray and start breaking them. There's more that you can do to get them broken. So
I like
a few more.
Yeah,
right?
But I just want to say that I like what you said. Soul tie literally lifts another person, sexual soul tie.
So, yeah.
A sexual soul tie lifts up an old-time principle that we learned, ignorantia juris haud et susa. That's okay, let me sound smart for a minute. You know, but ignorance of the law is not an excuse. Now, so avoid this, get knowledge, and then decide and be determined that it's time to break it. You have to make a decision. You have to stick with your decision. You have to be determined that it is time to come out of it. And listen, nobody can want to break a soul tie, sexual soul tie for you. You must say to yourself, I have come to a point where enough is enough.
Mm-hmm.
You must decide that it is time for me to come out of this place. I cannot live my life. Life is supposed to be stuck in cycles.
Mm-hmm.
Then you know that it's time for you to exit the cycle so your seasons can be taken advantage of.
Mm-hmm.
So you do that, you go to God, and then you pray for strength. Ask God to give you strength. Many times it takes strength to walk away. It
mm-hmm.
takes mental strength. It takes a certain determination, a certain conviction of your heart. And many people want to, but just can't find the strength to do so. So once you go to God, deliberately ask God for the strength to walk away.
Yeah.
And I would say also that if there are any physical items remind you of the person, mementos, you are keeping pictures, there are tons of pictures of you and him or you and her on Facebook,
well,
on Instagram,
pictures,
delete them. You know, if you are keeping the, you know, maybe he came over, he left a necklace, a watch, a t-shirt in your room, honey, throw it out or burn it. You know, get rid of all the physical stuff. Let it go, because a physical stuff can create a memorial and it can become a point of contact or a connection that takes you back to a place you don't want to go. I would say also that seek spiritual help. You know, go to your pastor, or if you're around us, come to us. And when you go to your pastor, two streams of things could happen. Number one, they got to counsel you so that mentally you are free. And number two, they have to take you to a deliverance if necessary, so your spirit breaks free. So there's got to be that. If there's counseling without deliverance,
mm-hmm.
it could leave you mentally reprieved but not spiritually delivered.
Right.
And if there's deliverance, it could let the spirit go, but your mind is still keeps wandering and going back to a place it shouldn't go.
Mm-hmm.
So I would say that the next thing you should do is to use the word of God to do two things, to force and to forge a new thought pattern. You have to change the way you think. If you know that every time I see a blue dress, I'm reminded of Cindy, and then I can't breathe, and then I can't live, and all of that, then, honey, you've got to stop seeing blue dresses. I don't know how you're going to do that. But the Bible tells us in Ephesians 3, verse 20, that God is able to do exceedingly above all you ask or think, meaning that spiritually, what you think and what you pray about are on an equal level. So if you are praying for deliverance, but you keep thinking about the person, you are literally pulling yourself back.
Yeah.
You are lifting up this way and pulling yourself down. So you've got to renew your thought process. Philippians 4:8, the Bible says, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are noble, whatsoever things don't contain your ex, think of these things, for those things are pure. This is Stephen's version of the Bible. Hallelujah. So, you know, you have to make a conscious effort to reprogram your mind. Get a new habit, get some new friends, do something, live your life, find something that will occupy you, go bowling. If you're black like me, learn how to ski. That should take you a while. Or go bungee jumping, you know. Do something that black folk don't do. That will take your mind off a lot of things concerning that partner. And also I would say that find an accountability partner. Let that person be somebody whose opinion you respect, somebody who spiritually or mentally you sort of elevate it so that you can show them respect, and then you can go to them and be accountable for whatever you are going through. That way it's a check on you and it's also an outlet for you. And lastly, very important, thank God continually for every step of your deliverance and your freedom. Don't assume that it's going to be one prayer and then boom, everything works out, you're free, yeah, you can go. If you've built up a sexual soul tie over 3 years, don't think that in 5 seconds perhaps. Many times we think that deliverance is an event, whereas it's a process. Mm-hmm. So celebrate every part of the victory. Mm-hmm. If I've lived without calling him for 5 days, yay, it's worth it. Mm-hmm. Now don't celebrate by calling him. Hello? No, but celebrate appropriately. Give yourself props. No, you don't want to survive. And then set another benchmark. Give myself another 10 days, another 15 days. Mm-hmm. Celebrate a small, and thank God for each milestone along the way. And pretty soon, you'll be free. All and right. Now, here we go to sexual abuse and don'ts. And I'll refer you to the doyen of sex.
Who, me? From
I'm just putting you on the spot.
So, yep, so that's done. You're done with soul ties. Hey, I hope you learned something. That was some deep stuff, man. So please take it seriously. Now, sexual dues, dating or courting. You know, Christians, we don't like using the term dating. It's a little bit too worldly for us. But hey, we like to say courting, but I'm going to use the two words interchangeably, okay? No judgment here. So sexual do's and don'ts of dating or courting. Okay, so if you tuned in just to hear about some sexual do's, let me get closer. There are no sexual do's in dating or courting. Again, there are no sexual do's. Nada, zilch, never, none. Okay, not going to get back. So there are no sexual do's. They are only...
Man,
oh, to make it dramatic.
I'm married. I'm married, and even I was scared.
They're only sexual don'ts when it comes to dating or courting. Okay, so we're going to talk about sexual don'ts of courting. I have dismantled the first part in 30 seconds. Okay, so don'ts. There is no sex during courtship or during dating. There is no sex. Don't let anybody deceive you. Don't let somebody find a scripture in the Bible, which I know somebody found before to be able to sleep with a fine young lady. So that, don't let anybody find any scripture to use that to get you into this bed. There's none. And first of all, premarital sex, the Bible says, it's a sin. One reason why there are no sexual dues is because sex before marriage is a sin. Alright, 1 Corinthians chapter 6 verse 18 says, flee sexual immorality. Flee sexual immorality. When it comes to temptations, we are supposed to resist, right?
And then
God separates sex and then says flee from sexual immorality. That tells you that he doesn't view it easily. He says, and you know, some people might say that, oh, I said in the beginning that sometimes people make us feel like, oh, the church talks about sex as if it's the only sin. There are other sins. Sex is as worse as gossip. It's as worse as stealing. We know that. But then there's still a little bit of a difference, because the Bible says right there and then in 1 Corinthians 6, 18, that every sin a man does is outside his body.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? But sexual sin is a sin against his body. Then he goes on, before he starts saying, yeah, it's my body, he goes on and says, ah, do you not know that the Holy Spirit? So it's your body, but it's not your body.
That's right.
You know, so every sin you see, your sin is like, is outside of, but this one is against your body.
Mm-hmm.
And that is what makes it serious. And that is why, yes, the church talks about it too much. It's not that it's any different. It's higher than some sins. It's just that it's on a different scale. And because of that, we take it seriously. So God says it's a sin. The one who created that, the sex, says that, hey, have it within these boundaries. For me, that is good enough. And for me, that was good enough while I was growing up. God says no to sex before marriage, and that is okay for me. But just in case it's not okay for you and you're thinking, oh, I don't know, I want to hear more, let's go through a few things. Having sex with somebody you're not married to, it weakens the trust between the two people involved, especially if they're two Christians. Because again, we're talking to both Christians and not Christians, but especially when sex happens between two Christians, premarital sex happens between two Christians, it messes up the trust. Because I'm thinking, okay, if you were willing to sin with me, if you were willing not to obey the word of God with me, why would you not go have the same thing with somebody else? Why would I trust you that you will keep yourself pure, you know, beyond just me? All right, can I trust you that you won't just, if you didn't regard sex, if you didn't think it was so important, if you didn't think that God saying that it was sin and serious enough, how can I trust you? And it begins to mess up with the trust between the two people. Again, the no-brainer ones, yeah, sex creates babies. sex creates babies. And sometimes people put themselves in situations where they didn't intend to. I always laugh. I said I wasn't going to say it. I always laugh when people come and say, oh, I didn't know. I didn't plan it. It was an accident. I'm like, dude, no. When, you know, two people have sex, most likely a baby is going to result. You know, so yes, babies happen when you're ready for them. STDs happen when you're not ready for them. Nobody's ever ready for STDs. So STDs happen and you don't want that, okay? And then also number five, it steals the joy and the connection in dating and in courtship. Dating or courtship is a time for romance, right? You know, a time, it's a mysterious time, a time where we're getting to know each other, we're giddy. It's a time to, you know, visit your intended home, get to know him, get to know her, figure out if you're compatible, you know, maybe intellectually compatible, are you spiritually compatible? Do you have things in common? You know, can he be the one to help you on the journey that God has put you on? It's just a period of discovery, a period of investigation, a period of just enjoying the simple things of life. You know, they're not serious things of life. Let's go get an ice cream. Sometimes we were close from work, like, you know, we used to work very late. Yeah. At 12, and we go to Frankie's and go and get ice cream. Mm-hmm. I mean, at this time, now that I'm married with 3 kids, I get the time to just skip and go get ice cream somewhere at midnight. You know, but that's the time to just enjoy the simple things of life and enjoy each other. Once you introduce sex in there, it becomes complicated. It becomes complicated. It messes up with the connection. And then all of a sudden you're suspicious. Okay, we just did it. All right. I see him talking to Beatrice. Is he going to do it with Beatrice also?
I don't know Beatrice, please.
Oh, God. So the only time that sex will not create problems is when it's introduced at the right time, mm-hmm. in the right season. You know, when God said that it should be introduced. Songs of Solomon, chapter 2, verse 7, says that do not awaken love before its time. Do not awaken it. Because when you awaken it, it's like, remember I said it's like a fire. When you awaken it too early, pastor says something, you say that a fire is a good servant and a bad master. Once it escapes its boundaries, it gets out of hand, you know, there's no controlling it. So please, let's keep it within the boundaries where God said we should keep it. And if you're not having sex with the person you're dating, it doesn't make you stupid. It's okay. You're just doing what God wants you to do, what God is asking you to do. And finally, it creates a soul tie. We just talked about soul ties. If that didn't scare you, I don't know what will. It creates soul ties. You don't want to be carrying burdens around. You don't want to be, you know, carrying, picking up demons and stuff from other people you've slept with and carrying them around, adding to your own baggage that you have from wherever else you're coming from. So yes, sex is great. Sex is not a bad thing. Sex is a gift that God gave to us to enjoy. Okay, so let's say Christmas is coming. I bought you a gift. Put it on the tree. You went and unwrapped it on December 1st. Sex before, it's something precious, it's a gift, and if it is a gift and it's precious, we can't treat it lightly as we do. There's nothing casual about sex, so please, there are no sexual dues. There are no sexual dues in dating or in courtship. Wait when the time comes, you will get it. You get it so much that you even get tired of it when they're coming. I wish I could say this in English. Is there a rating on this? So a friend's father used to say that, you know, that the thing that you're chasing, the time is coming when I'm seeing it, I'm not going to make it wrong. The time is coming when it's coming after you and you're also running away from it. The point being that at some point it will be there for you right in your bed and you're like, gee, another night again. You know, so please take your time, enjoy each other during this period, be pure, and when the time comes, you will be able to enjoy yourselves. And don't think that, oh, but okay, so if we don't test it, how am I going to know if you're compatible? My answer to that is always, if you can trust God with your salvation, your life, why can't you trust him to find your partner or to ensure that your partner and you are compatible when you get together? You know, so don't let that be the deciding factor for us to go, let's go try it and see. It's not a kind of milk that you can open, pour some, and then put it back in the refrigerator. Once you open, it's open. That's it. You know, so please, let us do it God's way. So now you're thinking, okay, but you know, so what am I going to do with all these emotions, all these feelings that are running through me? Can we kiss? Can we pet? Can we neck? Can we?
Yeah, we can.
No, you are not. Yes, we can.
You know, God, in his infinite wisdom, created, like I said before, systems that were workable to the enemy's shoulder. And in the same way that God said to them in the Garden of Eden, this particular tree, the tree of knowledge of good and evil, don't touch it. And, you know, and then they touched it. And for that reason, God had to drive them out of the garden, because the Bible said a tree from the tree of life.
Yeah,
and man would have
forever.
Been fixated in a sin forever. Mm-hmm. Now, the enemy is always working around these deceptions to deceive people. The thing about marriage is this, and you'll find that before you get married, when you're young and everything else, it looks like, wow, I can't wait to taste the cookie. I can't wait for it. I can't wait for it. My marriage is too long. I want it now, like a petulant child.
Mm-hmm.
But you'll find that once a child has a cookie in his hands, after a little while, he's like, oh man, that's cookie. It's nothing biggie. So many times, one of the biggest problems is that young folk or dating folk don't take time to do the other parts of developing the relationship, because those other parts in the long run perhaps will occupy more of their time and be more important than this, than just sex. But then, because the enemy allows this part to get highlighted, or the hormonal development or the maturity is not to a certain point, everything points in this direction, so they go get what they shouldn't get, and then by the time they get into the marriage, in about a year or so, everything is stale and dry, because hey, there's nothing new there.
The guilt that you carry.
I would say that, you know, stay away from that and build up things. Now, to talking about kissing, the Bible doesn't say anywhere that thou shalt not kiss, you know, but we call some things dead works because they are slippery slope. And one of the things I would say is this: have you ever seen anybody kiss without closing their eyes? Especially when they begin. Anybody that kisses with their eyes open is a witch.
I'm telling you.
Or a wizard, you know. So when you close your eyes, you escape into a fantasy world of imagination.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't travel that far and return quickly unless there's an intervention.
Mm-hmm.
Something checks you.
Mm-hmm.
Either the Holy Spirit taps you on your shoulder, or your pastor shows up. Now, why, you must ask yourself, why the eyes get closed? Because you don't want any interference with the experience.
Mm-hmm.
So if I was to ask you a question, anybody on the, watching us tonight, to just type it in where, on whatever platform, what is the primary sexual organ that you have? Some of you would suggest maybe it's a penis, or somebody would say it's a vajayjay or whatever, but actually it's not. It's up here. It's the mind. And what mind tonight?
Soul.
The soul. The soul. And so when you engage in a wrongful sexual act, you touch that part of you, and then it moves you away from the spirit completely into the flesh. And so you build up fleshly pleasures which don't go away, and your body starts adjusting to these pleasures. Now you have the experience of knowing things you shouldn't know, and even when you have repented, your body will still remind you of things that you have felt before. I always say to people, if you haven't experienced something before, just bless God that you haven't. Thank God that you haven't, because it hasn't become a temptation.
Right.
But if you've tried something before, then it becomes a problem. And so it is better to stay away from something that you haven't experimented with than to go play with it, and then it becomes an issue that you can't handle. When the fire gets too hot in your bosom, it's going to burn you.
Yeah.
You know?
And like what I say about nobody kisses with their hands behind their backs.
Yes, absolutely.
I haven't seen anyone like that.
You know,
who threw a challenge.
Once you start kissing, you become an explorer. Marco Polo, Christopher Columbus. You are looking out for looking for the mountains, the valleys, the hills. You know, the rivers, the oceans.
And before you know it, you're where you didn't want to be.
You are going far.
My pastor said, "Don't start what you can't finish."
What you can't finish, you know.
Don't start.
So you really want to be careful with some things. It can arouse sexual feelings that can be overpowering, and maybe at that point you don't know yourself, the extent to which your flesh gives you pleasure. Because everybody's at a different level,
all right?
Everybody operates at a different level. So suddenly, if people might think that maybe you become promiscuous. Maybe it's not a question of just being promiscuous because you're a lustful character or anything,
mm-hmm.
but you've explored and discovered something you shouldn't have discovered
too early.
So now it's bust, it's bounce, and you have to reel it in, and you really can't reel it in anymore. So, you know, some people say, well, if we have a blowjob or...
Even before you do the kissing, I remember also many, many years ago, we were in our early 20s, and we were talking to a spiritual mentor at the time, right? The same thing about kissing, and then he said something like, well, if you can draw the line, you know, and we all came out thinking, of course, after I grew a little bit, I realized that there's nothing like drawing a line. Because again, like you said, nobody really fully knows how they'll respond to these things. And sometimes you may think that, oh, I'm strong, you know. But then the Bible even tells us, he that thinks is standing should be careful lest he fall. So when it comes to your sexuality, you don't really know how you will respond to something unless you're actually in it and actually responding in that moment.
True.
So you don't really want to go there. It's a slippery slope. Whether you can draw the line or not, don't even go there. And the thing with also what I said about
you don't tempt fate.
Yeah, Jesus even said, well, if you look at a woman lustfully, you have sinned. How much if you touch a woman lustfully as you're kissing
and again
for things?
He's saying that because the whole thing starts in the mind.
Right.
So it's all a soulish problem.
Yeah.
And then it begins to control your thinking. It begins to, you know, control everything that you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
Now
jobs,
some people think that, okay, we'll do the Bill Clinton insofar as it hasn't become us lying together, there's no penetration, sexual organ to sexual organ, then I'm good to go, then I can do everything else and get around it. But listen, blow jobs, hand jobs, whatever
jobs.
You know in your mind what you've done 1,000 times already.
Right.
It's a complete no-no.
Yeah.
And please remember, sometimes, you know, guys get to a point where they're like, oh, maybe, okay, if I can just get, you know, half an inch or something, that's just the head, I'll be good. We're making all of these jokes and everything else, but nobody's, your body will never go where your mind hasn't first gone. Alright, so many times your mind has already gone there.
Mm-hmm.
And Jesus is saying, listen, when it comes to judging sin, it's like what happens in criminal law. The Bible does not concern itself. God doesn't concern himself too much with the act itself, but with the intent. If you've thought about it already, you've already done it in your mind, and then you're already guilty.
Yes.
You know, your intent goes beyond the action. So draw the line. No kisses. Don't with your hand. You know, and just remember, every time you are tempted, Jesus is watching you. You know, and maybe you can really put a little sticker with Pastor Steve on your dashboard or whatever,
right.
So I can be watching you.
What about living together before marriage?
Living together before marriage, I think it's a complete no-no.
Mm-hmm.
It can easily drive you apart. It can destroy the relationship. You easily get tired of each other. When you are stuck in a place where you are committed already, you know what you are in for. It makes it easy to say, I'm out of here. So maybe if you rush to go and live with him, you rush into his house to split bills or whatever.
Save up for the wedding.
It is unlikely that thing is going to last. Many times it comes to a place of failure because it just doesn't work, you know. And you're expecting a certain treatment, like you already he's expecting a treatment like a husband or a wife already, and the fullness of what must be done hasn't been done.
Mm-hmm.
That's not helpful. That's not helpful. So personally, I would not be advising you to cohabit, to move in, to hang around, to overhang, to spend weekends, to pack your bag and all of that, go on long holidays together, or none of that stuff.
Yeah, that too.
You'll be tempting fate and be creating soul ties. And
mm-hmm.
when it comes to a time to split up, it becomes a mega, 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 mega issue.
Okay, so yes, everybody's getting theirs today, right? Now we're moving into the married folk. If you're single, do not leave. Listen, put this in your memory bank and keep it for when you get hitched, okay? So now we're moving into healthy sexual habits in marriage. Healthy sexual habits in marriage. So now, during our marriage counseling, right? I must confess, I don't remember much from marriage counseling, but there's one statement I never forgot, and you haven't forgotten it either.
Never.
A marriage counselor says something. She said that sex is the highest form of worship.
Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Amen and amen.
Hallelujah.
We'll worship tonight.
Yes.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. So, sex is the highest form of worship, right? So that if it is, if it is the highest form of worship, then it must be done right, right? It must be done well, and it must
mm-hmm.
be done to the glory of God.
True.
So, sexual habits. Remember that God created sex specifically for marriage, for the marital relationship, to join us together, to glue us together. So, what are healthy sexual habits? Now, My go-to rule is that, listen, as long as we're married, anything goes. A caveat is coming before, don't. That anything goes, because hey, there's liberty, right? So anything goes, everything is fine, so long as it does not violate scripture. So long as it doesn't violate scripture, it's fine. And beyond just the violation of scripture also, both parties need to be comfortable about any sexual act that the other person is proposing. So there has to be that consent, where we both consent to what we're doing. Okay, it doesn't violate scripture, but then we all agree. Nobody should be manipulated into doing something that they're uncomfortable with in the bedroom. As far, even though there's liberty in there, at the same time, there should be enough freedom, there should be enough nakedness for me to say, nah, I don't think that this is for me, I don't think that I want to try this. So keep that in mind, okay? Do not pressure your spouse to do something that they're uncomfortable with. Sex is meant to be enjoyed. Remember the reasons we gave, one was what, for pleasure, for recreation. So it must be enjoyed. Now, oh, let me also go over what you said the first time about the four purposes of marriage, of sex in marriage. For procreation, obviously, is also a mode of communication. It's a way of telling you that I love you. I'm giving you the gift of me, right? So sex communicates so many things that words cannot communicate. Okay, so it's a form of communication. I'm giving the gift of me to you. You know, I am all yours. I belong to you and I belong to only you. And then also it's for just recreation, pleasure, and it's for release. God has made it such that we need to release some of the pent-up stress through the sexual act. So what are the second healthy sexual habits? First of all, there must be teamwork. It's not a one-sided thing.
Mm-hmm.
One person can't always be doing all the work, and sex is work.
Yep.
One person cannot be doing all the work. It's not every day. Sometimes, you know, it's a quickie, sometimes it's a longie, whatever it is. It has to be teamwork. We have to be in it together. Whether you feel like it or not, it is teamwork. One thing that I know is that both of you are not always have sex. At some point, there'll be a time when he's in the mood, I'm not in the mood, I'm in the mood, he's not in the mood. But then whether you're in the mood or not, and I've come to realize from my own personal experience that there are times when I'm not in the mood, you know, but when I become pliant, I really enjoy it. So, teamwork, let's do this together, all right? Also, it's important to communicate about sex. It's important to communicate. Sex is, it's depending on where you got your sex education, if you got any at all. You know, some of us didn't really get a whole lot of sex education, like from our parents. They didn't really sit us down to go through everything. You know, I'm sure there are people on the line who can identify with that. So depending on where you got it from, we all come to marry sometimes with certain hang-ups about sex. So it's important for the two of us to talk. Not so much, maybe you've learned it from a friend, you learned it from maybe your mother, from, you know, some sister or somebody. So you come with a whole, your baggage, his baggage, you come together, try and talk about it. What is sex to you? What is sex to me? And that is my favorite topic in premarital counseling, actually. So what is sex to me? What is sex to you? Where did you learn about sex from? What does this sexual act mean to you? You know, talk about it. Don't just tumble into bed and then try and grope your way around and figure out, okay, what do you want? What do you need? Talk about it. The things you like, the things you don't like. Talk about it. Don't just be there and say, oh, it's going to happen. Okay, tonight, if it happens, it will happen. Be intentional. That's what tonight is going to happen. And what am I doing to make sure that it happens? What am I doing during the day to make sure that it happens? What am I going to do during the night to make sure that it happens? Make sure that sometimes, right, sometimes you have to schedule sex. That is what I know he doesn't like. He's a big fan of spontaneity, which I think is also very, very important. But then there are times when you necessarily have to fit it in, because if you're not intentional about it, all the stresses, the children, the job, the meetings, the people will get in the way. And before you know it, 3 days, 4 days, 5 days, and it's counting and nothing is happening. So we need to be intentional about sex. It's not, if it's supposed to unify us, glue us together, make us one, and it helps us to release. We shouldn't, the less we do it, the more pent up we are. So many things are pent up in us that need to be released. And again, the longer it takes before you do it also, some people say that it affects the men's prostate. I don't know. You know, so if there's any doctor, you can type in there. I don't know. So you have to make sure that you're intentional about it. It's not good enough to say that I'm so busy. Oh, the kids keep me stressed out. Oh, the house chores. And hey, help each other at home. Help each other with whatever they need to do also to make sure that they can be ready for it. Be creative. Last time I quipped about the garage and you guys haven't allowed me to sleep. But hey, be creative. Different locations, not just the garage, wherever, you know. kitchen, bathroom, bedroom, wherever. Wherever, be creative. Creativity pantry. Also, the pantry. You said was spike and spice. You said something.
Spike and spice.
Spike, yeah. Spike, I don't know where you get these terms from, but spice and what? Spike.
Spike and spice.
Don't come and spike my drink or anything. I was talking about spiking of drinks, no. You know, but then be creative. Different locations, different times of day. See, some people, it's always be dark. No, get creative. Get creative. That also helps foster that unity. And sometimes, right, all the, like you were saying, sometimes people come for counseling and all the anger and all the issues they are going through,
it's really,
it's just building up from the bedroom. So please, so long as everybody's good in the bedroom, everybody's also happy on the outside. And be spontaneous. That's what he likes. Just be spontaneous. You see the other person, you know, and hopefully the other person also will be compliant. And then we'll have some spontaneity, which will spice it up and spike it.
There you go.
And another healthy habit, exercise. It improves your body image, stamina, and then it increases your libido. So please exercise. Don't sit in the couch 24. Don't sit in the couch 24/7. Okay, exercise. Build some stamina. As I said in the beginning, sex is work. So make sure that you build some stamina, and then so tomorrow we are going for a walk.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I don't want your stamina to decrease.
We are walking to kingdom come.
And then also, I wanted to chip in about oral sex before I bring Pastor in for the unhealthy sexual habits. Oral sex, the Bible doesn't address it. Me, I have searched, I haven't found. You will search, you will not find. Do not try to find some scripture and try and conform it to it. God, the Bible doesn't address it, so I will just leave it to the couple's better judgment. Again, remember what I said in the beginning, so long as it doesn't violate scripture, so there's no violation here, so long as both are comfortable with it, and they're okay with it, hey, you know, go for it. I know that in some traditions, it's a taboo.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm not going to mention the tradition. If you want to, please feel free. But in some traditions, it's actually a taboo. So, well, that I can't do anything about it. If it's a taboo, well, I don't know. But in that same tradition, we know that some of the men, even though it's a taboo, they still sneak out to
get the same thing elsewhere.
From that, you know, so, not from their own people.
Don't be too... you know, peevish about you know, oral sex. If it works for you and you like it, hey, go down on each other. God is not going to be sad about it. God is not going to be sad about it at all. So far as you're dealing with your conditions of marriage, I think it's great. Go for it. All right, go for it. Listen, all of you acting prudish and everything else. One of the things that I found out is that every man likes his wife to be a lady in the streets and a freak in the sheets. So get a book, get a mentor, learn something, pick up some skills, but avoid going to an excess and getting yourself ready. All right. Also, let me just add that if we have agreed that the brain is especially important, or the mind is important in sex, then let us learn to literally help each other in running the home, all right? You know, you do things together. Typical of African men, we want to sit around like daddy, big daddy, do nothing. And you've come to America, you're doing 12 hours, the lady's doing 12 hours, you're working, all of you are working hard, and then you get home, she's cooking your food, washing your plates, scrubbing the bathroom, feeding the kids, bathing the kids, putting them to bed, and then by the time she tumbles in finally at midnight, you are lying there with your sledgehammer. Come on, guy. Come on, dude. Do better than that.
He did
it. All right.
He did.
You have to do better than that. If you both work together, you both do stuff together, then it becomes fun. And again, the exercise part. You know, you literally own each other's body because you're married. This is sex within a marriage. So you have to encourage each other, force each other, teach each other, if you will, but get each other to where you want each other to be because you are helping each other. And trust me. Even if the one person doesn't want to do the exercise part or whatever now, as you grow older, they will see the benefit of having to exercise. Age will, and you know, you'll be old together.
Mm.
All right, so let me look at unhealthy sexual habits in a marriage. Unhealthy sexual habits in a marriage. Number one. And these are sacred. Don't watch porn together.
Or alone.
Now, my take and her take, or our take, is this: pornography is addictive. It creates wrong expectations. It sets your mind wrong. And the problem is, you might have watched it together, left and gone away. You think it's okay. Big Joe's like, oh, I kind of like that chica who I saw there. So now you've introduced him to something. Right. You've opened a can of worms. You don't want to open a can of worms that you can't handle. Please stay away from joint porn, singular porn, solo porn, bi porn, any kind of porn.
Yeah.
It steals the joy out of your intimacy, and then it also takes out the ability to be aroused by your spouse. Mm-hmm. Now you're looking at you have another mental image that you're buying into. That brings us again to the issue of the soul tie thing. So you can even be watching a thing and start creating a soul tie because it dominates your mind. Mm-hmm. And as you lie with a person, your mind is on somebody else. That is evil. You know, and it's addictive, and you go deeper, go darker, mm-hmm. deeper, darker. Next thing you know, you're flying out to LA to go and try out for a part in a movie. So stay with us, all right? Stay with us. Be good right here. Also, don't introduce self-pleasure.
Mm.
When it comes to issues of sex, don't ever be selfish.
Mm.
The danger about self-pleasure, masturbation, is that it encourages sexual fantasy. Mm-hmm. And then I think I'll leave the selfishness apart, come to selfishness. But it encourages sexual fantasy, and it tends to bring feelings of shame to some, addictive, and enslaves and everything else. But now you are the master of pleasing yourself. There is no way you can share the same kind of intimacy with the person you are with, because if that person hasn't developed, like, you know exactly how you can do something to yourself, and until you're able to pass it on. And many times maybe you are shy to tell him or tell her that, hey, okay, how do you know that if I do this it will work for you? I'm sorry, I was trying to.
Right. And sex is not even meant to be done. It's not a one-man thing. It's not a one-person thing. It was designed to be shared.
But many times people are caught in a place where they feel like, you know, okay, they get desperate. I just want to do this or whatever. But the reason why it doesn't work is that it breaks that dependency on the other person to help me get there.
Mm-hmm.
And once you become an all-in-all to yourself, it creates a big problem. So please avoid it. The third thing I've mentioned is selfish sex. When I say selfish sex, be willing to wait for your partner or work with them. Work with them. Too many of us guys, you are simply like a microwave. You are ready to go, heat the food, you are done. Now, you know, with your wife, it's going to take her a minute. It's going to take her time to warm up, to get where you are. And that's when the work part comes in. You know, you have to come to a place where you are willing to put in the work and to wait, not be in a hurry, like, okay, you know, boom, 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 and then you turn around and stop that.
Stop it.
If you are reported to me, I'll cane you. All right? Sex toys, I wouldn't encourage it. Again, it leads to self-pleasuring. It leads to building up individual skill over mutuality, and that it creates a self-dependence. And the more you get independence, the more you feel like you can do it by yourself. It begins to feed into things that could even lead to a divorce. So I wouldn't encourage it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the other day, the lady called me all the way from, where was it, Maryland or Virginia, and the question was about ménage à trois. And we had a very interesting discussion with her, and my conclusion was that it's a complete no-no. And it's not because maybe the Bible was said, well, Pastor, I know what you say because my pastor told me don't defile the marriage bed, but I want to know more.
Yeah.
Why not? And I said, okay, let's talk about this. Why not? What will happen to you if you bring somebody to your bed and unknown to you, if you were a woman and you brought another woman, your husband starts fancying the other woman, or vice versa.
Yeah.
Or their soul ties created, that now it becomes an issue.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of things that could go on in there. You just don't. The marriage is between two. Let it remain between two.
Third parties, human or non-human.
Thank you.
You
know, whether it's a cat or a dog or whatever.
Whoa.
No. No way. No way, Jose.
Mm-hmm.
All right, selfish sex. Oh, they were trying
to
focus on your self satisfaction. Anal sex. No definite scripture, but every orifice has its function.
That's right.
You don't need. Well, okay, then that could defeat the other one about you know. So, well, I would just say that. The anus is designed for a certain function.
It's designed to push out.
You know,
not to take it.
It's designed for a certain function. Now, again, the Bible doesn't say that or say anything about it. I would say that it's a no. It's a no-no. Have a good, healthy discussion with your husband or your wife and come to your conclusion about it. But we would discourage you from doing that because we don't want you at a certain age. You're 45, you're buying Pampers for yourself because you've lost, you know, your sphincter muscles because of some behavior.
Right.
So please, I would rather advise that you stay away from that.
And it's
not going to help you.
I guess for me, the question also will be, why do you want to have anal sex anyway with your wife? You get what I mean? Because just as you said, the organs are designed for certain things. It's not designed to stretch as far as the vagina stretches. The whole head can come out of that. It's designed to stretch, to take in. It's sterile. You know, the back side is not as sterile as that. It's painful. It's something that you're sort of putting your wife through, something that is painful. So why? What is going through your mind? Why do you want to go there? Things like that. And is it because you've seen it somewhere? Is it because you're just curious? At that point, you may probably need some counseling also. So have a conversation, not only between the two of you, but maybe you can, like, somebody call pastor and ask about it. Call your pastor and ask him. And but as we will just tell you that we think that is a no-no.
The good thing with us is that you know you can ask us any question that you have, and we'll answer you freely. And so we would say, we would seriously recommend that you don't you don't do anal sex, you don't put yourself through unnecessary troubles. If you found a man who said that it's all I've been doing since I was 17, maybe I would advise you to come for counseling and we'll reevaluate him and we'll see whether he's worthy of your hand. But I'm hopeful that it won't come to that. But anyway, it's almost 8:30. It's about an hour and a half since we've been speaking. So obviously we cannot cover every single detail that I would love to cover. Maybe it's a question around an area you'd like to ask. So please feel free to fire away, and I'll be willing, and Pastor Mo will be willing to answer your questions now.
To the best of our abilities.
Yes. Pastor Mo is very experienced. She has all the answers. I'm a complete novice, so I'll defer to her, and then when she passes it on, I'll try to help you.
Tongue in cheek.
Are soul ties created every single time you have sex outside of marriage?
Oh, no, you're taking that.
No, go ahead.
Well, I mean, again, from everything that we said, that is the implication of it, that yes, a soul tie is created every time you have sex out of marriage. There is no other way for me to explain it, because remember what Paul said, if you join yourself to a harlot, you the two become one. So once you leave, there's still that connection that was created that was beyond the fleshly connection. So you move that, you go to another person. Yes, so there could be multiple soul ties created that all need to be broken. I was a preacher who was telling a story about another preacher who came to him to say that his ministry was not really progressing. So he took him through a series of conversations, and then he found out that, he asked him that, look, how were you before you became a Christian? He said, yeah, I had about 5 sexual partners. Okay, so then, because sometimes, he said that sometimes soul ties can affect, like you said, can affect everything else that you do and actually can derail your ministry. So he said he took the other preacher through deliverance, and once, as they were going through the deliverance, you know, he wrote down the names and everything for him. Then they got to, I think, the number 3 or number 4, and the one being delivered started screaming that you can't have her, you can't have her, you know, and the name was Angela, and it was one of the girls that he had been with. So then the preacher remembered that, oh snap, Angela was deep into witchcraft at that time when they used to date. You know, so every sexual encounter you have establishes its own soul tie that also needs to be broken. So if you've had 10 partners, 12 partners, yes, you have to break the soul tie that came into being with each and every one of them. I know that is scary, but listen, there's nothing that Christ cannot do and the blood of Jesus cannot do. Okay,
right. So that's an excellent one. I was just going to say that there's a soul ties, we've spoken about the mental and the emotional connection, but there's a spiritual component also. So maybe the person doesn't play on your mind so much. You've walked away from the person. You don't even remember their name. But spiritually, a demon enters, or a demon could easily take up that place, because it's a sin. It's a doorway that leads to deeper spiritual problems. And the demon could enter and create more problems. Like this Angela situation. A demon just entered. So he is forgotten about Angela, but a demon is now operating. So think about it on that level. You might walk away and feel like, well, I don't remember his name, I don't remember who it was. But that's a one-night stand, I'm okay. When you are spiritually checked, you have about 150 people walking in the body, one body.
Can someone pray against soul ties before having premarital sex in order to avoid it?
Jesus is Lord. You cannot. You cannot pray.
Can somebody pray that God, I'm about to commit murder, but don't let the import of the murder get you, or whatever.
Yes.
You cannot pray to preempt something that scripturally has been said or is there. I'm about to break the rules and defy my father, but Lord, even as I insult my father and slap my father, let the curse against or not honoring my father come upon me.
No.
Ce n'est pas possible.
Some people who have casual sex will argue that if there is no connection with the person they are having sex with, then there's no soul tie created. Is that accurate?
It's not about your intention, it's about your connection. I'll take you again straight back to scripture. It was just no connection. Nobody has a connection with a prostitute. You just wanted a release.
Mm-hmm.
So you went, there was no connection. But then he says the two have become one.
Mm-hmm.
The flesh, you know, has joined. So like, that argument does not really hold water. It's just to give them some sort of an easement of conscience for them to do what they're doing. But no, it's not true.
What if there aren't any physical reminders of an ex or previous partner, but they consistently appear in your dreams? Can that be a result of soul tie?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
You mentioned it,
and again, times... You didn't connect on that emotional or you know, in a soulful way, but a demon has taken advantage of it to begin to do some things in your life. And sometimes, this is even the scary part that I didn't mention. Sometimes it is not even the person that begins
names and tell them, I think as young as 8, 9, 10, you can talk to them in plain language about it. It's hard though. I started talking to mine. I think that I haven't talked to my 5-year-old about sex yet, but I'm trying to use the right names for the sexual organs, you know, for her to at least begin to understand. But at least we've had some talk with, I think the second one is 10. Now I'm going on to 11. I think the first time we broached the subject with them, he was 10, you know. So I think that it all depends on how you frame it, you know, to make it age appropriate. Trust me, it's not that to have. Now the other one is turning 13, so I'm gonna go a little deeper. That'll be his birthday gift. As I've been told, but that's gonna be his birthday gift. Go deeper a little bit, you know. But then I think that whenever you think that you're comfortable, start talking about it. No, not when you think you're comfortable. When you think that they can comprehend or understand what a penis, what a vagina is, begin to start with things like, don't let anybody touch this part, this part is not for that, this part is not for that. Just preparing them to have the talk as they grow. So many things around them that is introducing them to sex. So if you don't tap in to it early and start talking, they may get it from the wrong places, you know. And sometimes also the hint is when you think your child is so innocent and then he or she says something, you're like, whoa, then that is the time to now, I think, for once we hear them talking about what, Oh, I know what semen is. At that point, you're like, oh, you're thinking he's 9, so he's innocent. But no, once he knows what semen is, let's begin to talk about it. So just watch out for clues like that.
No, but okay. I don't even like it. The semen and innocent. That has nothing to do with innocent. He's still innocent. But
sometimes we're thinking.
Yeah. I'm
right.
I'm just correcting the thing that let's not. If we use the word innocent, it makes it feel like they're guilty or something.
No.
But
no.
Sometimes,
let me explain myself.
If
then.
We don't start, they get you.
All right.
Yeah,
okay. Because
if we don't start, if we don't start early enough, somebody else is going to step in and supply the information. And the worst person you want to teach your kids about sex are friends, because that's what's going to lead them to go to the bathroom to go and discover things. So if you tell them early, the day we are told about going to the bathroom, they know what you said, it becomes a counterweight or a counterbalance to that wrong information they are going to receive.
Does marriage negate prior soul ties?
No. Yeah, please explain.
No, it doesn't, because whatever exists, when you come to marriage with what you carry already. So it doesn't negate it at all. Whatever baggage you have, you're carrying with you, you still have to work at it, you still have to get it off your back, you still have to defeat it. And that is why it's dangerous, because if you are an innocent girl, you know, a young girl, you lived in a home, not a house, but a home, you were trained properly and brought up properly, and you find this guy, and they always say that girls like, you know, they like dogs or crazy guys or whatever. So you find this guy who's been with about 20 girls or whatever, you're mad over him. Listen, you're marrying him and about...
For your spouse, I'm saying she.
Wife.
Okay, so she's created, you know, some barriers around certain things that need to be broken. So talk to her, find out why, and if you can help her overcome it, then I think that it's fine. But if after going through all of that, okay, let's get some votes, let's talk to somebody, it's abuse your mind, feel uncomfortable, it's okay. There are 1,001 things you can do. You don't need that particular sex show, you know, style to do anything for you. Remember, again, in marriage, right? Or not even in marriage, we love. Remember love, right? Love puts the other person first. Okay, love is kind. You put the other person's feelings first. So if it's something that you're so uncomfortable with, the point where it makes them unhappy, if you talk about it, it's okay. Just let it go.
Okay. What are the scripture violations regarding sex and marriage?
Scripture
violations. Maybe the First Corinthians 6, the one we've been talking about.
Okay, maybe that's what we're talking
about. Just read 1 Corinthians. Is it 6?
How do you handle a porn-watching spouse in a marriage? So your husband watch, or wife watches porn and wants to reenact it. How do you handle that situation?
That's a big problem. Because your husband's never going to be Big Mike. You know, he's never going
to
be Big Mike.
And
a lot of the things that... It's like watching porn, it's like watching wrestling. You know, the things are staged, they are acted. These people are given drugs to enhance their performance, to help them stretch it out and all of these things. So if you're watching that and expecting that, you're creating problems for yourself. You're creating something that potentially could become a deal breaker in your marriage. So I would heavily ask that person to desist from that, because it's an unrealistic benchmark you're setting, and it's going to create you problems.
What can I do to cope with sexual desires that might arise while my partner is away, say in a different country or different continent?
Hot showers, cold showers, prayer.
First of all, understanding the place of sex is important. The place of sex is important. Or my wife, maybe it is, you know, for a good reason that he or she's out of the country. God has given us the gift, is it the fruit of self-control, all right? And because God put that desire in you, God is not going to let you sin through that desire. He's able to help you, you know, curb it till your partner comes. Is that a woman or a man asking? Is it? Doesn't matter. Right.
Yeah.
God is able to help you curb that desire until your husband or your wife gets back. So take it into prayer, occupy yourself with other things, you know, pick up a new activity. Do not redirect your thinking. Philippians 4:8, and then also do not get yourself in places that arouse you. Do not watch movies that will arouse you. Do not watch do not read things that will arouse. Just try and sanitize your environment, you know, as far as sex is concerned, and channel your energies elsewhere. But ultimately, God is not the only one who can help you, you know, keep it in check until your spouse comes.
It's a heavy challenge, but I would say that don't buy into the stories about trying to do things by technology, FaceTime or something. Wires get crossed. Things could happen, and you could find that maybe, let's say your husband is in the army or something, his phone has been picked up by his mate and he's watching, and then he replies, go on baby, and then your husband comes and you're like, did you like it? He's like, no, do I like what? It's like, weren't you watching? You kept texting and saying, go on baby, it wasn't me. So technology can cause a lot of mishaps. You know, you don't want people recording your videos or recording your conversations or whatever. So I would say, just try the abstinence route. Will it be easy?
No.
Do I know what it feels like? No. But I'm just begging you and saying, for your own sake, it looks like there might be alternatives, but the alternatives could land you in big trouble.
So I think you just answered this. I just got a question around phone sex and marriage, but you just said no.
Yeah, because I think that, I mean, I don't know much about phone sex, I haven't tried that before, but I'm thinking that phone sex probably involves self-pleasuring, masturbation, stuff like that.
Yeah.
So again, it goes back to what we were saying. You don't want to introduce that into your any third person, whether it's a spirit, it's an object, it's a human, you don't want to introduce them into the marriage bed because they can lead you down a slope that you may not be able to climb out of.
Mm.
Okay. So those are all the questions that I have.
Awesome.
Yeah. Let me check. Yes, those are all the questions.
I guess it means we covered everything, so they don't have any questions.
Hopefully.
Which is great.
Did you want to pray for singles and then pray for marriages?
I'll pray for singles. You have my people.
Lord.
And so, Father, we just want to say that we thank you for the opportunity to just use this medium to reach your people and to have these conversations that will improve their spiritual health and help them to wait upon you as they prepare themselves. I pray that you will lead your children. The Bible says that no trial or temptation has come that is not common to others. I pray for the grace to go through difficulties and challenges without compromising. I pray that your hand will be upon them. For the one who has engaged by mistake, by deliberation, or through some other means that wasn't their choice in an act that has created a soul tie, Father, by the mercies of the blood, I beseech you, let it be broken now in Jesus' name. If there is anyone who was watching or listening whose soul has been tied up by a sexual soul tie for some reason, who cannot seem to break free, who is being hindered, being kept, being literally stopped from progressing, I pray that the power of the blood will break it. I pray this afternoon that if there is any one of your children who is under the bondage of a demonic power, who has taken advantage of one mistake they made or mistakes they made to enslave them spiritually and to hold them captive and to demand of them sexual activity, let it be broken by the power of the blood in the name of Jesus. I pray above all that you will bless every one of the ones who are single and dating. I pray that you will order your steps, Lord, throughout the period of courtship, that you would teach them that which you want them to know. The Bible said you taught Moses your ways. You showed him the things that please you, the things that pertain to your processes, your character, your nature, your persona. But to them that did not want to know, you showed acts. I pray that these ones will be ones that you show your way, that you will take pleasure in them, that you will delight in them, that when you look upon them, Father, you will bless them because they bring joy to your heart. I pray that, Father, for every one of these single ones, may the door for matrimony be open in the name of Jesus. May they find the right partners, husbands that are God-fearing, wives that are God-fearing. May they find partners who are resourced, positioned, capable, and able. I pray for people who are positioned mentally, emotionally, financially, spiritually, to step into the door of matrimony. I pray that their marriages will be blessed into flourishing. I pray that your grace will lead them in choosing partners, and that when they enter into matrimony, Lord, you will cause them to see supernatural increase, like you did for Abraham, like you did for Isaac, like you did for Jacob, like you have done in the precedence of scripture. Remember them and favor them. I thank you that through all the journeys they are in, the confusions, the difficulties, your mighty hand will sustain them, and the power of your name will be revealed. I give you all the glory in Jesus' matchless name. Amen.
Amen. And so, Father, I lift all marriages before you this evening. We thank you for the establishment of these unions, oh God. There is nothing that you did or there's nothing that you do that is not good. It is for your purposes that marriages come into being. I pray that you bless every single marriage that is connected to us through this online medium. I pray that you will take up residence in the homes, Lord. I pray that your love and your peace and your joy each marital home. I pray, oh God, that you will bless unions with children. I pray that you will cause them to band together, even as they multiply, even as they subdue the earth. Oh God, put a man and a woman together. I pray, oh God, that nothing will separate the marriages, oh God, that are connected to us online and everywhere else, but you continue to keep husbands and wives glued together. I pray that you shall be in marital beds all over the world. I pray, Lord God Almighty, that we will help cultivate healthy sexual habits to your glory. We pray that whatever we do as married couples, oh Lord, in our bedrooms will glorify your name. If there be any persons, oh God, having problems with their marital sexual life, I pray, oh God, for your intervention, whether it is a health problem, oh God, whether it's a psychological problem, I pray that you will step in, Heavenly Father, and help them through it. I pray, oh God, that what any other hindrances to them having a fulfilling sexual life will also be broken. Any marriages being hindered by soul ties, I pray, oh God, that you break them. Any marriages, Lord God Almighty, suffering from misunderstandings, I pray that you break these misunderstandings of them, that marriages will prosper and marriages will grow to be that which you created it to be. I pray, oh God, that any persons going through any unhealthy sexual habits will have the courage and the ability to walk away in the name of Jesus. Those addicted to pornography, Heavenly Father, I pray for their liberation in the name of Jesus. Those who have introduced foreign matter, third persons into their marriages to contaminate and defile the marriage bed, I pray that you grant them the ability to walk away and to change their ways, oh God. Any contamination, Lord God Almighty, brought into marriages by extramarital affairs, I pray, my God, that they be broken in the name of Jesus. Bless every home, Lord God Almighty. Let husbands and wives stand fast together, for indeed, two will put to flight 10,000. My God, when they are really united, there is nothing that they cannot achieve. I pray for children, oh God, that have been born into these marriages, that you will bless them also, that you will grant them healing, that you will grant the families resources, even in these times, to care for their families. I pray for marriages where children have not even yet been born, those who are crying for fruit of the womb. I pray, my God, that you will bless them, because when you created marriage, you said that we should go forth and multiply, open wombs, Lord God Almighty, that even tonight, as husbands and wives come together in sexual intimacy, Lord God Almighty, let babies be formed. We thank you and we bless you, my God, for we know that stronger marriages make stronger churches and make stronger nations. And so cause these marriages to stand against all odds. So God, those who need help, provide divine help. But even the marriages that are prospering, the marriages that are doing good, I pray that you fortify and you strengthen them, oh God, and let them not give the enemy any foothold, that in the end, Lord God Almighty, all victory will belong to you, and we will all look up to you and say thank you. We thank you and we bless you again for tonight, for all that you have led us to speak. Let it take hold in people's minds, my God, and cause them, Lord, even to be doers of that which we have taught this evening. Let them improve in particular, and let whatever they do, Lord God Almighty, bring you glory. We thank you and we bless you now and always in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Pastor Moore.
Oh,
awesome.